the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
My brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do. Through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary, Ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Christ.
Let us pray. O God, who have called us to participate in this most sacred supper, in which your only begotten Son, when about to hand himself over to death, entrusted to the Church a sacrifice new for all eternity, the banquet of his love, grant, we pray, that we may draw from so great a mystery the fullness of charity and of life. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Exodus. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, "This month shall stand at the head of your calendar. You shall reckon it the first month of the year. Tell the whole community of Israel, on the 10th of this month, every one of your families must procure for itself a lamb, one apiece for each household. If a family is too small for a whole lamb, it shall join the nearest household in procuring one and shall share in the lamb in proportion to the number of persons who partake of it. The lamb must be a year old male and without blemish. You may take it from either the sheep or the goats. You shall keep it until the 14th day of this month. And then, with the whole assembly of Israel present, it shall be slaughtered during the evening twilight. They shall take some of its blood and apply it to the two doorposts and the lintel of every house in which they partake of the lamb. That same night, they shall eat its roasted flesh with unleavened bread and bitter herbs. This is how you are to eat it: with your loins girt, sandals on your feet, and your staff in hand. You shall eat like those who are in flight. It is the Passover of the Lord. For on this same night, I will go through Egypt, striking down every firstborn of the land, both man and beast, and executing judgment on all the gods of Egypt, I, the Lord. But the blood will mark the houses where you are. Seeing the blood, I will pass over you. Thus, when I strike the land of Egypt, no destructive blow will come upon you. This day shall be a memorial feast for you, which all your generations shall celebrate with pilgrimage to the Lord as a perpetual institution." The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night he was handed over, took bread, and after he had given thanks, broke it and said, "This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, also the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the death of the Lord until he comes." The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Before the feast of Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to pass from this world to the Father. He loved his own in the world, and he loved them to the end. The devil had already induced Judas, son of Simon the Iscariot, to hand him over. So during supper, fully aware that the Father had put everything into his power, and that he had come from the Father and was returning to the Father, he rose from supper and took off his outer garments. He took a towel and tied it around his waist. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and dry them with the towel around his waist. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Master, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus answered and said to him, "What I am doing you do not understand now, but you will understand later." Peter said to him, "You will never wash my feet." Jesus answered him, "Unless I wash you, you will have no inheritance with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Master, then not only my feet, but my hands and my head as well." Jesus said to him, "Whoever has bathed has no need except to have his feet washed, for he is clean all over. So you are clean, but not all." For he knew he would betray him. For this reason, he said, "Not all of you are clean." So when he had washed their feet and put his garment back on and reclined at table again, he said to them, "Do you realize what I have done for you? You call me teacher and master, and rightly so, indeed I am. If I, therefore, the master and teacher, have washed your feet, you ought to wash one another's feet. I have given you a model to follow, so that as I have done for you, you should also do." The Gospel of the Lord.
My brothers and sisters in Christ, at the beginning of this sacred Triduum, as I represent the Holy Father in this to this country, I wish to assure you of Pope Francis' prayers and heartfelt affection for you, your families, as we celebrate the holiest days of the Church liturgical year. And this evening, we celebrate the month of the Lord's Supper, at which Christ instituted the sacred priesthood and the sacrament of his body and blood. The rubric of the Roman Missal instructs the preacher, and so I will do that, saying, "The homily should explain the principal mysteries that are commemorated in this Mass: the institution of the Eucharist, the institution of the priesthood, and Christ's commandment of brotherly love. These mysteries are a celebration of God's nearness to his people. The Eucharist, whose institution occurs at the Last Supper in the Synoptic Gospels, is a sacrament of the closeness of God. In the Eucharist, the God does not give us a thing, a reward for the privileged few. Rather, he offers us himself. He offers us his own body and blood, echoing the words of the Gospel. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. He gives us the totality of his life." The Gospel is taken from the beginning of the 13th chapter of the Gospel of John and recalls the love of Christ for his apostles when he humbled himself to wash their feet, leaving them an example and making them priests at the Last Supper. Through the priesthood, the whole church experiences the closeness of God. Recently, in addressing a symposium on the priesthood, the Holy Father mentioned the need for the priest to be close to the people. And I quote Pope Francis, "Closeness to the people of God, a closeness that, enriched by those other forms of closeness, invites and indeed demands that we imitate the Lord's own style. That style is one of closeness, compassion, and tenderness, in which we act not as judges, but as good Samaritans, who acknowledge the wounds of our people, their silent sufferings, the self-denial and sacrifices made by so many fathers and mothers, a style of closeness that allows us to pour balm upon wounds and to proclaim a year of favor from the Lord. It is imperative to remember that the people of God are hoping to find shepherds in the style of Jesus." End of quote. What is this style of Jesus, if not closeness? Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. During the Last Supper, Jesus gives his disciples the commandment to love one another as he loved us. The next day, he will demonstrate what loving them to the end would like. But even at the Last Supper, he shows the depth of his love in action with the simple gesture of washing his disciples' feet, the gesture of a slave who would wash his master's feet after a long, dirty, muddy journey, that Jesus himself would take on the form of a slave and do this service for his disciples reveals that there was and is nothing he would not do to serve and save us. Most people would feel very uncomfortable at that type of service. But Jesus insists on performing the gesture. In the ancient world, to approach God, one had to be ritually clean. Many religions had purification rituals. Jesus' gesture of washing his disciples' feet was a type of purification to make them fit for worship. Elsewhere, in his high priestly prayer, Jesus asked his Father to sanctify his disciples in the truth. Indeed, the truth is the bath that makes men fit for God. We cannot approach God if we don't live in the truth, if we lie. As Pope Benedict XVI once wrote, the bath that cleanses us is Jesus' love to the point of death. Jesus' word is more than a word. It is his very self. His word is truth, and it is love. Jesus makes us fit for worship. This is a pure gift. But he adds, "If I then, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet, for I have given you an example that you also should do as I have done." It's very simple. We have to imitate him. It is not as simple as that, by the way. It is a gift with a task. It is too easy to reduce this take to an invitation to imitate the Lord's humble service. We certainly must do that. However, the washing of the feet is also a symbolic gesture which points to Jesus' death. The whole life of Christ is a mystery or sacrament by which he draws near to us in order to transform us by his love and renew us from within in. By making a gift of himself, he makes us fit for worship and to do his Father's works. Of course, the true washing is that of baptism, which cleanses us from our sins. As we begin this Triduum and reflect on the Paschal mystery, we see that the sacrifice of Calvary was anticipated already at that Last Supper when Jesus instituted the Eucharist. Yet at Calvary, his Sacred Heart was pierced and blood and water flowed out, the blood of redemption for the forgiveness of our sins and water for the purification of our souls and to make us of a new creation. By baptism, we are immersed into Christ once and for all, acquiring a new identity as one who dwells in Christ. In the life of every Christian, not to mention priests, the sacramental gift of baptism constantly requires completion, a new washing of feet, or ongoing conversion. There is a constant need to be cleansed from the various forms of filth we encounter in the world and even from spiritual worldliness, so that we may be ready to enter into divine worship. The mercy offered by priests, not only in the celebration of the Eucharist, but also in the sacrament of penance, is a tangible reminder that Jesus is continually bending down to wash our feet, to carry out his service of purifying us, of washing the dirt from our souls. This persistent service of Jesus is best understood as the purifying power of his love, the means by which Jesus, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. This perpetual need of purification, which is at the foundation of the priesthood, is also present at the beginning of every authentic renewal of the Church. Christ seeks to renew his priest and church through his mercy. To the priests gathered in this basilica, and I greet them, I am happy that a good number of them came tonight, especially those who regularly hear confessions here, know of my gratitude for your priestly service and for that of your brother priests who are generous in washing the souls of the people of God. How lucky we have to have priests with us, so that everybody may have the chance to reach holiness. The Eucharist, which was instituted immediately afterward, is a continuation of that extreme mercy. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. Jesus made the connection explicit in commanding the apostles to receive and drink the chalice of his blood, poured out for the remission of sins, and to do that in his memory. On Calvary, the following day, he culminated his priestly sacrifice, begging the Father to forgive those for whose sins he was dying, for they know not what they do, said Jesus. This evening, brothers and sisters, we remember the gifts of Christ's love, the priesthood, and the Holy Eucharist. I conclude with the words of Saint John Paul II, who wrote of the significance of the Eucharistic sacrifice. This sacrifice is so decisive for the salvation of human race that Jesus Christ offered it and returned to the Father only after he had left us a means of sharing in it as if we had been present there. What more could Jesus have done for us? Truly, in the Eucharist, he shows us a love that goes to the end, a love which knows no measure. True love knows no measure. A love which is total gift of ourselves, like Jesus. Amen.
Said to his disciples,
I give
said to his disciples,
I give you a new commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. So I give you a new call.
Our Lord fulfilled the new commandment of love by laying down his life for our salvation. Confident in his goodness, we now offer our needs and those of the whole world.
For our Holy Father, Pope Francis, all bishops and priests, that through the grace of their ordination, they will be encouraged in faithful service to God's people, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That leaders of nations will work towards true and lasting peace and make every effort to ensure freedom of religion and a greater respect for the sanctity of all human life, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our military personnel serving overseas, for law enforcement officers and fire and rescue workers, may God bless those who serve and protect our nation. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For an end to war, violence, and terrorism in our communities and throughout the world, and for an ever greater respect for the dignity of all human life, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those who struggle with doubts and temptations may come to know the real presence of Christ in the Eucharist and be strengthened in their faith, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the church will be blessed with many vocations to the priesthood, diaconate, and consecrated religious life, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our benefactors and for all the intentions enrolled in the National Shrine's Lenten Remembrance, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That our deceased loved ones will be welcomed to the eternal banquet prepared for them in heaven, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Eternal Father, hear the prayers of your church and grant us a deeper sharing in the mystery of your love, which we celebrate in this holy sacrament, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
We invite you to join in the support of the ministry of the Basilica of the National Shrine. During these unprecedented days, where our ministry has been greatly limited, your contributions are all the more appreciated. Thank you for being as generous as your means allows.
Deus sibi est.
Pray, brethren, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Grant us, O Lord, we pray, that we may participate worthily in these mysteries, for whenever the memorial of this sacrifice is celebrated, the work of our redemption is accomplished through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is truly right and just,
our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For he is the true and eternal priest who instituted the pattern of an everlasting sacrifice and was the first to offer himself as the saving victim, commanding us to make this offering as his memorial. As we eat his flesh that was sacrificed for us, we are made strong, and as we drink his blood that was poured out for us, we are washed clean. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory as without end we acclaim. To you, therefore, most merciful Father, we make humble prayer and petition through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world, together with your servant, Francis, our Pope, my brother Wilton, the Bishop of this church, and me, your unworthy servant, and all those who, holding to the truth, hand on the Catholic and Apostolic faith.
Remember, Lord, your servants. And all gathered here, whose faith and devotion are known to you. For them, we offer you the sacrifice of praise, where they offered for themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls, in hope of health and well-being, and paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true.
Celebrating the most sacred day on which our Lord Jesus Christ was handed over for our sake, and in communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious Ever Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and Blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon, and Jude, Linus, Cletus, Clement, Sistus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysogonus, John and Paul, Cosmas and Damian, and all your saints, we ask that through their merits and prayers in all things, we may be defended by your protecting help.
Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of your service, that your whole that of your whole family, which we make to you as we observe the day on which our Lord Jesus Christ handed on the mysteries of his body and blood for his disciples to celebrate. Order our days in your peace and command that we may be delivered from eternal damnation and counted among the flock of those you have chosen. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, on the day before he was to suffer, for our salvation and the salvation of all, that is, today, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes raised to heaven, to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands, and once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the Blessed Passion, the resurrection from the dead, and the glorious ascension into heaven of Christ, your Son, our Lord, we, your servants and your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty, from the gifts that you have given us, this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance and to accept them as once you are pleased to accept the gift of your servant Abel the Just, the sacrifice of Abraham, our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. In humble prayer, we ask you, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us who, through the participation at the altar, receive the most holy body and blood of your Son, may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing.
Remember also, Lord, your servants who have gone before us with the sign of faith and rest in the sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace.
To us also, your servants, who though sinners, hope in your abundant mercies, graciously grant some share and fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints, admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon through Christ our Lord.
Through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord, you sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Amen, amen, amen.
At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior Jesus Christ.
The kingdom, the power, and glory are yours now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter my room, but say this word and my soul shall be
Thank you.
Let us pray. Grant, Almighty God, that just as we are renewed by the supper of your Son in this present age, so we may enjoy his banquet for all eternity, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Thank you.
Jesus.